Macmillan Audio presents The Silver Witch by Paula Brackston. Read for you by Marisa Calin. Prologue. It is as if she has always known that one day it would come to this. One day she would have to face it. Her darkest fear has been there to test her from a distance all her life. Years of imagining, thinking, wondering what it would be like to be swallowed up by the waves, or swept away by a fast-flowing river, or held beneath the sunny surface of a sparkling swimming pool, all have led to this place, this moment. Gingerly, she moves toward the edge of the boathouse jetty. Her fingers are already losing their colour in the damp chill. She crouches, then sits, lowering her feet into the water. The intense cold is a shock. Her breathing accelerates as she twists around and lowers herself over the edge and in. The ancient, neglected wood is slimy with algae, and her fingers start to slip. She gasps, clawing at the wet wood, but cannot get a firm grip. With a feeble splash, she slides into the water, bursting into tears of relief and terror as her feet find the silty lake bed. The water level is just above her waist. Raising her arms, elbows bent, she edges toward the entrance, inching her way along the uneven surface, the sloping uneven surface. By the time she reaches the gable end of the boathouse, the water is up to her armpits. She knows she is in danger of hyperventilating, of being sick, of fainting. No, no, no. Mustn't trip, mustn't stumble. Small steps, come on, feet. Pretend we're running. Running in slow motion. Fleet feet, strong steps. One foot in front of the other. She pushes through the reeds, causing small waves to bounce back at her from the timber walls. She raises her chin as the water sloshes against her face. With every step, she fights rising panic, panic that threatens to send her falling into the water, panic that might be the finish of her. She reaches the low boards that block the exit. The moment has come. Now, she must dive beneath the water, push through into the unknown. Fight the tangle of weeds and swim to the outside. She knows if she thinks about it any longer, she will not move. So in one desperate, sudden action, she forces herself under the surface. The sensation of going beneath the water is more than she can stand. She loses her balance, falling through the twisted undergrowth, her feet sliding so that she disappears into the brackish blackness. She reacts as she has always feared she would, as she always imagined so vividly in her nightmares. She inhales. The mouthful of water becomes a lungful in a soundless scream of terror. Tilda feels time stop. Her intellect tells her she must get up, must break the surface, must push up, grab something, find air. Her instinct tells her to fight and flail and clutch and claw. But the blackness is enticing, the silence seductive. And the cold, the bone-deep cold, has her in its tight embrace, numbing her will as well as her body. Chapter 1. Seren. All is darkness, blessed night. Freed from light and troubled vision, my thoughts are fed instead by the howling of the wind outside. The sound forms pictures in my mind, where I see the trees moving in the raging air. Willow and hazel pull at their roots as they dance. Birch and ash bow to the mighty force from the skies, but the oak will not bend the knee. He stands stubborn and steady, would sooner break than yield. My mind is like the willow. It flexes and springs. My heart is a knot of oak. Let them try to wound me. Let them try. Tilda, Feet find firm ground, thudding into dry mud. Nike on hard earth. Breathe in, breathe out. In on second left footfall, out on second right. Lengthen stride, a couple of inches, no more. Pace, rhythm, run, step, the poetry of movement, of exertion. Tilda loves to run. Tilda needs to run. Her style is loose, fluid, easy, but with power and purpose. And with every step, she lets her mind overlay the beat with plump, juicy images. Images she will gather together for when she returns home. A crop harvested from the amber autumn landscape through which she now runs. All her best work has been created this way. Running charges her body and her mind. If she does not run, her thoughts become composted in her head, overheated and overcrowded, potentially fertile but unusable. Too much of a mass to be employed as separate artistic ideas. She turns off the woodland track and follows the slender path out of the trees and across the open fields. Breathe, pace, breathe, pace. Heart strobing against ribs, lungs efficient, trained, strong. Turf opening up, stretching out. The vista is uplifting, lush, plush, velvet grass. Green is the colour of life. Her left foot hits a small stone, and her mind is momentarily jolted out of its meditative state, her rhythm disrupted. Cold air stings the back of her throat. The day is cool, but dry. The year is turning the corner away from summer, but the fertile rot of autumn has not yet taken hold of the landscape. The smell of fungi is just faintly detectable. The crunch of broken nutshells underfoot still only occasional. Another full moon will see shortening days and lengthening shadows. Tilda's long legs stride over the meadow to the bordering hedge. She finds the narrow gap and squeezes through, her breath loud in her ears as she stoops to pass beneath the brambles. A squirrel dashes out and fluffs its way up the nearest trunk. Tilda picks a glossy blackberry and pops it in her mouth, then presses on, winding a now familiar route between neglected hazel and blackthorn. At last, she is in the open again, alongside the lake. A smile, as involuntary as a hiccup, curves her mouth. As on each occasion that she runs here, she is reminded of how she is drawn to what she fears. Deep water is the nightmare of her childhood that she never grew out of. Nothing she can imagine would induce her to step off the path and break that silky surface. And yet she loves to run here, to be close, to be fascinated by the terror and the beauty of it. Laughing at her fear a little each time. Like the thrill of watching a horror movie. A reminder of what it means to be alive. And how close at hand death is. Any death. His death. Mustn't think of it, not now. Mustn't falter. Quickly now, upper gear. Legs and arms help each other. Calf muscles tightening. Ignore that. Run, girl, run. Fleet, fast, foot sure. I see you, waiting water. I see you. One more mile. Turning for home. Home. Though she forms the word in her head, it is still hard to think of the cottage as anything other than the place where she lives. For what is home? Surely more than a set of rooms, a roof, an address. Home suggests belonging. Suggests warmth, safety. Companionship. Love. When Matt died, all those things died with him. So she returns to the cottage. It is the place where she lives now, has lived for a month almost. It is the place where she must live, where she will work, where she will simply be. Home is too much to ask of it. For now. She has not completely circled the lake today. But loops back, so she passes St. Cunnog's Church and the old schoolhouse a second time. The church is solid Norman, boxy and stout, built to withstand time and the damp air from the lake. Its graveyard is kempt and well used, but even so there are some ancient tombstones, which lean toward each other at angles that give away their age. Like so many old men huddled in conversation after a few pints. The old schoolhouse is a building out of place. A 19th century idea of rural perfection, with its mullioned windows, low eaves, and rustic charm. No longer a school, but the cozy home of an evidently proficient gardener. Tilda jogs on by, taking the footpath to the lane beyond. She crosses the narrow road that will be busy with visitors to the lake at weekends, and leans into the steep slope to the cottage. T. Gwynne is a humble farmworker's cottage, positioned high on the hill and approached via a testing climb. It sits steady and serene, and ever so slightly smug, as if enjoying the view and laughing just a little at the puffing people who struggle up to its blue front door. The whitewashed stone gleams in the autumn sunshine, sharp against the fading colours of the mountain pastures, while the slate roof is an exact match for the stone walls that mark the boundary of the garden. Breathing heavily, Tilda unlatches the wooden gate at the end of the bumpy track and secures it behind her against opportunist sheep. She reminds herself that one day she will enjoy tending the modest lawn and flower beds and recovering the neglected plants. One day. A path of uneven flagstones leads around the side of the little house to the back door, which she unlocks with the chunky key she keeps beneath a pot of thyme. The temperature inside is not noticeably warmer than out, but she is too warm from her run to mind. She raises the blinds to let the young day into the low-ceilinged room and places the filled kettle on the hot plate of the Rayburn stove. The aged beast heats so slowly it will take some time to boil. Already, in the few short weeks she has been here, she has formed habits. There is comfort to be had in the repetition of simple tasks, reassurance to be found in ritual. Routine has a way of helping to make the new familiar, of filling the mind with purpose and, in doing so, leaving less room for unwelcome doubts and fears. She takes milk from the fridge and pours herself a glass to drink where she stands, leaning against the sink. She can feel her heart begin to steady after its exertion. The milk refreshes and chills her in equal measure. She glances at the kitchen clock and notices it has stopped. Another dud battery. So much for value brands. Tilda levers off her trainers and heads upstairs to the tiny bathroom. The shower is old and temperamental and coughs unpromisingly when she turns it on. She leaves the water spluttering and pulls off her beanie and running clothes before deftly undoing the heavy plait that has restrained her hair. Steam begins to mist the mirror, so that her reflection is even more ghostly than usual. She wipes the glass and peers at the pale young woman who peers back at her. Swirls of vapour blur the image. I could fade away entirely. It wouldn't require effort. Just grow a little fainter every day. She steps into the shower and lets the hot water cascade over her. Her white blonde hair becomes slick, darkening to pewter. Her skin flushes. Now she is the most coloured, the most opaque she will ever be. She should have come with instructions to render visible add warm water. Her mother once told her that when she had first held her baby daughter in her arms, she doubted anything so fragile, so thin-skinned, so seemingly insubstantial could survive. But Tilda had shown her, had grown tall and strong, had proved her wrong, as in so many things. By the time she has dressed, dried her hair so that it hangs straight and loose, a crystal curtain down her back, the day is properly awake. She takes her mug of tea and steps out onto the small patio of mossy flagstones beyond the front door. As always, the view is like a deep breath of pure oxygen. This is why we bought this place. This. The flat piece of garden extends.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.